This week on Channel 8 News, we look at a few events held by some of our Northwest multicultural organizations, a few speakers who stopped by the university, and more. Channel 8 News starts right now. Thanks for tuning in to Channel 8 News. I'm Jacob Wood. Last week, Kawasaki, Green Tower Press, and the Department of Language, Literature, and Writing sponsored the latest installment of the Distinguished Lecture Series. Jackie Harding has more on that event. Jackie?
Robert Long Foreman and Jacques Shea Rancourt visited Northwest in the living room of the Student Union last Tuesday night. Rancourt is the author of the book Novena, which is a collection of love poems.
My book is a coming-of-age story set in the Appalachian Maine wilderness. So it's a queer story of coming to terms with one's sexuality amid spiritual isolation and a disrupted relationship between a father and a son.
Foreman is the author of the book Among Other Things, which is a collection of essays and short stories about inanimate objects.
My book is about a number of things. Most of the essays in it, it's a collection of essays, and most of them are, to one extent or another, about an inanimate object, its history, its significance, either in a broad historical sense or in a personal sense. If there's a unifying theme, it is inanimate objects, and it's sort of taking one at a time and sort of coming at it from as many angles as possible.
Jacques Rancourt wrote his book so others with the same perspective could bond over the similar stories.
Part of it was I felt there was a need for this voice. You know, we hear a lot from an urban gay utopia, but we don't hear much from a pastoral one. And so I thought it was a perspective that is often overlooked. But also, I first wrote the book for myself. And, through many years, decided it was something I wanted to share with an audience.
Robert Foreman wrote his book because he didn't have a full outlook on what his future would hold, so he decided to start writing.
Mostly, I think I may have an undiagnosed nervous disorder. It was nothing like intellectually. There was really no intellectual stimulus. It was more like just a reaction to. I started writing it when I was finished with a master's degree program and didn't have a job coming out of it. Didn't know what to do with myself. And just didn't know what to do, and suddenly didn't have school in front of me, and so I found a walking stick at my parents' house, and just thought I'm going to write about this. And slowly, over the course of about 10 years, I continued doing that, and went to a degree program for it, and accumulated enough of a body of work to collect it. So it was really like, I'm working on books now that have more of an idea behind them, but this was just like, I don't know what to do with myself. I'm going to write something. So.
This was the last of the Visiting Writer series for this semester. Catch more Visiting Writers next fall. This has been Jackie Harding reporting for KNWT, Channel 8.
Thanks, Jackie. The Olive Deluce Fine Arts Building celebrated the opening of an exhibit featuring ceramist Mitchell Spain. Mitch Bomberger got the scoop on the new exhibit. Mitch?
On Monday, February 20th, an artist by the name of Mitchell Spain came to talk to students about his art and the process that he goes to making it. He started the day off at 9 and went till 5 and talked about his art and how the process of making it.
Some of the favorite pieces I made have been ones that incorporate the ceramic threaded process that I created. I wrote an article about it for Ceramics Technical magazine. And that was just a real challenge to come up with that process of making threaded clay. So it's like a cap that would thread onto a ceramic bottle, porcelain bottle. And so just that challenging aspect is always fun. So I grew up in rural Iowa, and so a lot of my work is based upon rusty old cans or objects. So just seeing that imagery and that's a lot of where my inspiration lies, is those old junk piles around the farm. And so I grew up in a town of about 7,000 at the time, so pretty small town, and I lived out in the country as well. So I've been doing ceramics for about 8 years. I started in a little bit in high school and then kind of went away from it for a while until about halfway through my undergrad, and then I got my Bachelor of Fine Arts in ceramics in 2012 from the University of Iowa, and then I got my Master's in Fine Arts in ceramics as well in 2015 at the University of Kansas.
And then open the floor up for any of the students that had any questions.
Do you hand draw a lot of the details, or do you piece them together?
No, I do everything on Photoshop. I'm not a very good drawer.
At 7, he talked about the conceptual side of his art and what inspired him to make those pieces.
So tonight I'll be talking about more of the conceptual side of my work and kind of what drives me to make this work, why I'm making it, and kind of what I want to get out of, you know, what I want people to get out of seeing it. And I'll be doing basically an artist talk to talk about the conceptual side of my work, and it'll be a slide presentation with photos of the finished pieces of my work and kind of the journey I've gone through and the development of my work from early on in undergrad to current.
The exhibit is open from 2 to 5 on Wednesdays all throughout March. This is Mitch Bomber reporting for Channel 8 News.
Thanks, Mitch. We'll be right back after this with your Northwest Event Report. Don't go away. Welcome back to Channel 8 News. I'm Jacob Wood, and this is your Northwest Event Report. On Tuesday, February 28th, there will be a Mardi Gras party at the Oak Point Assisted Living and Memory Care Center. The celebration will be from 2 to 3 with Louisiana-inspired food and music. On Wednesday, March 1st, the International Involvement Center will be holding another afternoon of the International Coffee Hour. The event will be at the BD Owens Library from 2:30 to 4. Students are encouraged to stop by for as little or as long as they would like. On Thursday, March 2nd, the Maryville Knights of Columbus will be holding a fish fry. The fish fry will be from 5 to 7 at the St. Gregory's Parish Hall. Children 5 and under are free. Children 6 through 12 are $3 and adults are $8. The Northwest Tower Choir and Iowa Western Community College Chamber Choir will perform a joint concert Thursday, March 2nd. The concert will be in the Charles Johnson Theater in the Olive Deluce Fine Arts Building at 7:30 p.m. Friday, March 3rd, in the Horace Mann Gymnasium at 7 p.m., there will be an evening of English country dancing as seen in film adaptations of Jane Austen. Participants will have the option to learn the basic steps. Regency dress is encouraged, but not required. Also on Friday, March 3rd at 7 p.m., the Northwest Dance Company will be performing its spring show. The show will be in the Maryland Auditorium and the Ron Howson Center for the Performing Arts. On Saturday, March 4th at 7 p.m., Sigma Society will be holding a concert to benefit the American Cancer Society at the Ron Howson Center for the Performing Arts. Regional bands will be featured, including Kyrese Redivine, Hereafter, A Greater Tomorrow, and GGE. The Northwest Dance Company will also be there to perform. On Sunday, March 10th, from 10 a.m. to noon, the American Legion Post 100 and Boy Scout Troop 190 will be holding a breakfast at the American Legion Post. It costs $5 for children, 6 and under, and $8 for adults. Well, that's all for your Northwest Event Report. When we come back, we take a look at some community news and events. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Channel 8 News. I'm Jacob Wood. Congressman Emanuel Cleaver spoke at the Black History Month Soul Food Dinner last week. Channel 8 reporter Tyler Broff had the opportunity to attend the dinner and speak with Congressman Cleaver. Tyler?
Good evening.
On Tuesday, February 21st, Northwest held its 6th annual Soul Food Dinner in the Student Union Ballroom. The event drew in a sold-out crowd, as there were many important speakers, but all eyes were on Congressman Emanuel Cleaver, who was the guest of honor for the event.
I was fortunate to receive an invitation from Dr. Simmons, who actually is Juanita Cleaver Simmons, my first cousin, to speak at the Black History Program. I was very excited about coming to Maryville, because I'd never come to this school before.
The congressman took full advantage of his invitation.
It gave me an opportunity to see this university, but it also gave me an opportunity to share some of my historical views during Black History Week here, and also, and maybe more important, the opportunity to meet new people.
Prior to the speech, guests enjoyed a nice meal provided by Northwest.
The catfish clearly won as the most valuable item at the event tonight. The catfish was you call women hot. The catfish was hot.
Aside from the meal, Cleaver says he enjoyed the evening as well.
The soul food dinner, the atmosphere here was all conducive to a great evening as it relates to African American history and its richness. It was a rewarding evening for me, and hopefully some of the things I shared with the crowd will be of some educational value to them as well.
One student who was in the crowd was junior DeLon Walton.
I took a lot. I learned a lot of history just being at the event today. Also learned that he was an Alpha just like I am. I'm an Alpha Alpha Fraternity Incorporated. And I learned the background of history, how slavery started, and that was a big eye-opener.
If you weren't able to attend this year's event, Walton can fill you in on what you missed.
Well, you definitely missed out on the food. Catfish, the chicken was good. But they also missed out on a good speech, how he came around with different solutions and scenarios and put them all together. It was just brilliant. And I feel like everybody should go next year.
This is Tyler Bruff reporting for Channel 8 News.
Thanks, Tyler. Last week, I got the chance to get an exclusive one-on-one interview with President Jasinski and his wife, Denise. This was their first television interview together since he took the presidency in 2009. Let's take a look. So we were honored to have you guys here sitting together and answering our questions here. Moving past the spring months and kind of into those topics that have been happening all over the university and all over the state, really, mm-hmm. What's it look like for budget cuts, Dr. J?
Yeah, it's pretty tough right now. You know, if you look across the nation, and you just then just circle into our region, Oklahoma colleagues, Illinois, Kansas, Nebraska, Iowa, Missouri. So as I talk to our colleagues, talk to our students, faculty, staff, it isn't just us. It's not just Northwest Missouri State, but it's everywhere. Our colleagues in Oklahoma, 16% cut this year. So we've got a 10% cut that's been proposed a lot. There's a long way until May 5th when the state budget's due. So.
What's one thing that, you know, a lot of people think that they know a lot about the Jasinski family? You know, we see you out at events and things a lot. What's one thing that people may not know about the Jasinski family?
Waiting for my wife. I'm trying not to do eye contact to see what my wife says about that.
We're just a normal couple. We're a normal couple that sometimes I think we forget that when people are in the public eye a lot of times, mm-hmm. that they're just a normal family trying to grow, trying to spend time together, trying to celebrate all the joys and yet work through the difficulties and then life, you know, and just live life and see where it's going to take us. I don't think there's, I mean, for me, that's what it is. We're John and Denise, who moved here from Michigan all those years ago.
As we wrap up this interview, is there anyone you would like to thank for being in the seats that you are today?
Well, I would like to thank John. This is one, you know. I mean, we were just coming to this little town for a couple years, and I was going to get my education degree here. And I'd like to thank Fred Lamer for bringing us here. Sometimes I always tease Fred.
I'm not thanking Fred.
I always tease Fred.
You go through that litany, and it starts with the, you know, with the Lord and being blessed that way. But, man, you know, I wouldn't be here without Denise. So, yes, and your kids. And your kids have given so much. And, you know, hopefully they've been given so much, too, and some responsibilities that go with it. But they've given so much.
So many people have been nurturing and very, very supportive of us being here. So there's just been many, many people.
Well, on behalf of Northwest Student Media and Channel 8 and myself, I just want to thank you guys for sitting down with us for this interview and agreeing to answering all of our questions. And we wish you the most luck in the remainder of your presidency, as many years that may be.
Yes,
and many improvements of the Gaunt House to come. So
thank you
very much.
Thanks to you and your colleagues, too. Yeah,
thank you.
To watch the full interview in its entirety, check out our YouTube channel at /KNWT TV. The men's minority organization recently held a tribute to the ladies to celebrate the women on campus. Tyler Jones has more. Tyler?
This is Burley Justice filling in for Tyler Jones. On Saturday, the men's minority organization MMO held their annual Ladies Night event honoring all of the women and the glory, power, and courageousness they bring to the world. The event was full of skits made by MMO and acts put together by multiple people and organizations.
Oh, he just put his hands on her! Don't you dare harm her! Someone, please call 911!
One of the sections of the tribute was three music videos at various times put on by Cliff Scott. Channel 8 News got to sit down with Cliff to talk more about the event and the videos.
Watching the videos that I created up on the wall and everyone cheering and really enjoying them, that just made me feel really good inside.
Individuals from MMO went all out for the event, from skits to poems to even a proposal from Northwest student Nelson Butler. Northwest student Artie Tuttle talks about the importance of these kind of events.
People need to understand that ladies are also strong too, because you know, you got single women out there, single mothers that still raise their kids. And it's just like dedicated to them, because you know, it's just giving them the honor that they are still strong and you know, they can do things without, you know, a man.
The event was a great way for men to serve and to honor the women of Northwest. If you missed this year's event, make sure you look out for the next tribute to the ladies' event. This has been Bradley Justice reporting for Channel 8 News.
Last weekend, the First Christian Church held a Red Door Chili Supper fundraiser for the Children and Family Center. Our Bradley Justice has that story. Bradley?
On Sunday, the First Christian Church of Maryville held their annual Red Door Chili Festival fundraiser for the Children and Family Center. All proceeds go to the victims of domestic violence and sexual assault. With the Children and Family Center helping over 700 victims last year, Channel 8 News got to sit down with Executive Director of Children and Family Center, Linda Mattson, to talk more about this year's goals.
So our goals for the upcoming year are just to make sure that more victims know about our services. So I've been going out into the community to meet people, to talk to them about our services, just so we can spread the word. I want people to know that we serve women and men at the shelter.
According to the National Coalition Against Domestic Violence website, on a typical day, there are more than 20,000 phone calls placed to domestic violence hotlines nationwide. Linda wants victims to know they are welcomed at any time.
We, you know, people think of us just as a shelter where somebody will come and stay, and we do offer that services, but we offer lots of other services. So if people are in a relationship where they think that, you know, they just have some concerns, or they feel unhappy in that relationship, they feel like something's not right, they can just come into the center. We're located here in town on 2nd Street. They can just walk in and talk to one of our advocates. They can get some support.
The Chili Festival was a great way to enjoy some chili while helping the Children and Family Center fight against domestic abuse. This has been Bradley Justice reporting for Channel 8 News.
Thanks, Bradley. When we come back, we'll take a look at some national headlines. Don't go away. Man's attempt to take on pests in his yard backfired Monday. The man hoped a contained grass fire would drive out the moles burrowed underground. But as Catherine Hessel from our CNN affiliate reports, the man's neighbor is now the one without a home.
Michael and his brother Darian were driving home when they saw one of their neighbors waving for help.
It started right here in this little area. In this little area right here in the middle of the yard. And that's when we saw the fire. And so that's when we hopped out the car and assisted the neighbor that stays in his house. And we just started grabbing buckets. But as we was grabbing buckets trying to stop the blaze, it just started spreading. It started spreading towards in the front yard and started spreading towards the backyard.
The fire caught onto the side of the house next door, and that's when Darian ran to the front door.
I was in the basement, I'm working on some music, and I had it kind of loud, but I heard a banging at the door.
When Mark Huey answered the door, he saw that most of the front of his house was on fire.
We just started trying to keep going with the water until the fire department came, and by the time the fire department came,
Huey's neighbor told him that the fire started when he was trying to burn moles out of the yard.
We have a problem with a mole infestation in the yard. And he was trying to burn up the moles, and it got away from him.
The Riverview fire chief says because of the dry, windy conditions, it didn't take long for this fire to spread quickly.
So we had three backyards and a front yard going at the same time, along with a house.
At the time of the fire, Huey's wife was at the hospital getting her first round of chemo treatment. He says he's glad that she was not home and that the brothers stopped and saved his life.
Could have been a whole lot worse. Nothing inside was damaged. The exterior of the house is a mess, but I'm safe and my wife is safe and God's in control.
There's a growing fascination with President Trump's power, or what some might call his whiplash-inducing handshake. Jeannie Moe shows you some people who are offering a defense against it.
Chances are you'll never shake the hand of President Donald Trump, but with all the recent coverage of his bizarre grab-and-yank handshake technique, some are getting defensive. For instance, this instructor at a Columbus, Ohio martial arts academy.
Here's what you do, and I'm not suggesting you do this to the president.
This fourth degree black belt demonstrates a wrist lock that the president's Supreme Court nominee obviously didn't deploy.
So as he grabs really hard, pulls me in, I go with it. I wrap around the elbow, I bend the wrist in, the other hand wraps over top of the knuckles, boom.
Heck, Canada's prime minister managed to thwart the grab and yank without resorting to a wrist lock. An inventor who specializes in useless inventions created the Donald Trump handshake robot so he could test various anti-grab-and-yank measures.
Okay, first we'll try regular handshake. Hand on shoulder. Okay, I'm gonna try squeezing his hand really hard.
The robot is timed to yank randomly to keep the element of surprise. When none of the techniques worked, he opted to fit the robot for a fist bump. But perhaps the most mesmerizing recreation of the presidential handshake was done by a CGI artist in Sweden. This was kid stuff for Anders Ritar, who works at home on his farm.
So how long did you spend on this animation?
About 3 hours, including feeding the chickens and eating some lunch.
Even Harry Potter author J.K. Rowling retweeted it. As for that wrist lock, demonstrated by the black belt...
Now you have what we call the gooseneck.
Pretty sure the gooseneck would give the Secret Service goosebumps. Jeannie Moe, CNN, New York.
Well, that's all the time we have for this week. For more information on stories that matter to you, like us on Facebook at /WatchChannel8News or follow us on Twitter at KNWT8News. Cat Chat is up next, and from all of us here at Channel 8 News, I'm Jacob Wood. Have a good night.